Good afternoon. So, I am Vijayanand. So I am the chief cyborg at Cybilla. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about capacity planning. So the first question is, So why do you need to plan for capacity? Okay, thank you. So any answers on why you need capacity planning? Why you need to plan for capacity? Scaling. So if you don't do any capacity planning, I'm pretty sure you're going to end up like that. So what is the capacity? So we build web apps every day. So each web app has, you know, different purpose. So, you know, the capacity is not, you know, is not universal for each web app. So if you take a blog, you know, the capacity of that blog is the number of page views or the number of comments it can, you know, serve per hour or per day. And if you take a forum, you know, the number of page views, the number of posts the members can, you know, post, or the number of registrations it can handle. That is the capacity for a forum. And if you take a e-commerce application, so the number of searches, you know, the number of orders it can handle per hour. That is the capacity for that e-commerce application. So before you go on planning your capacity, you know, you just have to define what are your actions. Okay, what is the, so each action will will contain like a couple of user actions, like visiting a web page, adding some items to their cart, or clicking some buttons, you know, that will generate more page views. So for each action, you need to, you know, define the performance threshold. Like it should be completed within like 10 seconds or 20 seconds. Then, you know, to simulate the real load, you have to, you know, take a combination of these actions. Then plan for that. Okay, so Scriptbox is one of our clients. So Scriptbox is a mutual fund broker who helps you invest in mutual funds online. Okay, the main flow for Scriptbox is the sign-up flow. The flow contains generally like 1 to 3 landing pages, the 1 to 3 landing page views, and a 3-step sign-up process. The whole entire sign-up process has like some 40 fields to fill. So I just have taken the threshold for completing the sign-up as 20 seconds. And the capacity I am planning to support is around like 50 users signing up concurrently. So this is the methodology I'm going to follow. First, I have taken an initial deployment architecture. Okay. Then I simulate the actions of the users using Capybara. Then I calculate the number of concurrent users this architecture is supporting. Then if I have not reached the goal, again, I will, unless the data I have collected, I'll find the bottleneck, and I redeploy with a new deployment architecture which, you know, rectifies the problem in the first architecture. Then again, perform the same simulate the actions, and, you know, we iterate till we reach the goal. So why Capybara? Why not, you know, you can, you know, still benchmark your applications or, you know, plan for capacity using Apache Bench. So if you take Apache Bench, it is only, you know, it can only simulate GET requests, but generally Rails applications has more POST requests. Like many of the users are going to, you know, submit forms and you interact with the website. So it will generate not only GET requests, it will have also many, you know, AJAX and other type of requests like PUT requests. So also the Apache Bench, we are going to, you know, it only hits a single URL and it is going to hit it repeatedly. So when a user loads a page, that page is going to, you know, load assets, all the images and everything, you know. So Capybara actually puts the near real scenario load on the web server, on the whole system. So this is the measurement setup I have taken. So there is the master control. This is our Rails application which will be sending commands to the RabbitMQ, which in turn relays these commands to the Capybara process. This process will be running in a DigitalOcean nodes, or you can run it on any other, you know, high memory server. So once master control sends these commands to Capybara node to suppose simulate a sign-up process on the web application, okay, then we have the production setup of the actual live website. This will be set up in another kind of instance. Okay, and that the Capybara process actually run the sign-up process and post back the test results, like what is the total time taken for this sign-up process, again back to our master server. Okay, in the production server, it is going to send us the publish its CPU usages, memory usage, and the disk tests, along with the breakdown of the CPU usage and memory usage for each process. Okay, so generally we use Capybara for acceptance testing. It actually runs on the local rack server, which is booted by the Capybara. So this we have to configure to run on a remote host instead of a local one. So we have to give the our measurement host where our production environment is set up. Then we have to tell it not to run the not to start up boot up the rack server. And after including the Capybara DSL, to run the test. And so if you are writing acceptance test, you can almost take the specs from that acceptance test. With minor modifications, you can just put it here, and you simulate your user actions. Then after simulating it and publishing your results back to the master, we have to reset your session and cache. So this will actually simulate a new user. Okay, so we start with one Capybara process. We give a command to one of the nodes to start simulating sign up. So once it has done the 10 sign ups, we issue another command for another process to run simultaneously. So after 10 sign ups, we have two Capybara processes running the sign up process. So like that, we continue increasing the load at regular intervals until we see that the resources are maxed out, or if we have like very long sign-up times. Okay, so the initial deployment architecture I have chosen is the single machine architecture, where we have all the Apache, the delayed jobs, and the MySQL process and the parsing. Everything is in the same box, the same machine. And we collect data about what is the CPU usage of each process. So if you take a look at that, the average sign-up completion time for each sign-up is around like 90 seconds, and we have 8 concurrent Capybara nodes running. So after we have added the 9th node, if you see the total sign-up completion time goes on increasing. So we have taken the 8th node, it is optimal. After the 8th node, the sign-up time increases. Okay. So for our calculations, for users to have the optimum, the best experience, the maximum concurrent Capybara process it can support is around 8. So the entire sign-up process has around like 6 page views. So now user comes to scriptbox.com, they just go to 3 pages and just start filling the sign-up form. Between these performing 2 actions on the website, there will be something called thinking time. I mean, they'll be thinking, they'll be reading some content, or they'll be thinking what to fill up in this form field. Okay. So that is the what I am calling as a think time. So on an average, the think time for between 2 actions that will generate the next page view is around like 10 seconds. So between 6 page views, we have around like 5 think times, which will amount like 50 seconds. So the total time taken for a normal human visitor to complete the sign-up process would be around 69 seconds. So if you just convert this per hour, how many concurrent users it can support? It's around like 29 users. Okay, that is 29 concurrent users signing up at the same time. Okay, so our goal is to support 50 users, but it's still, you know, it's, we have not reached our goal. So if you take a look at this graph, the green one is the passenger CPU usage. Okay. The passenger is taking the highest CPU, highest load. So we are going to scale the passenger service in the next architecture. So I have taken a new architecture. We have a load balancer as Nginx, which will be passing all the requests to the two passenger servers, which in turn talk with the MySQL server. So if we again repeat the same experiment on it, and we just graph the whole data. So now it is for the same 90-second completion time, it is supporting up to 14th node. So in this architecture, we can support up to 14th node for that minimum average time of 19 seconds. After 14th node, the signup completion time increases continuously. So this is the memory usage. If you just take a look at that, the passenger servers are maxing out on the memory after like 8th node. After that, this stays constant, but still up to 14th node, they are still able to serve the optimal time. Okay, we convert the same the same Capybara process into the concurrent users, the concurrent human users. So we get 51 users approximately. So we have reached our goal. If you take a look at the graphs, the passenger server is still maxing out there on the memory. So we might have to increase the passenger the resources of the passenger systems to support more passenger processes. And if you take a look at the MySQL memory usage, it grows continuously as we increase the load. So it still has not reached the 100% memory usage, but I think after once we scale passengers, then the MySQL server will be hitting its bottlenecks. So that's a recap. So what we have done, so we have taken a single machine architecture, then we simulated the signup actions. So we have not reached our goal, so we determined the bottleneck as a passenger, we scaled that passenger server, then we again redeployed in a new architecture. Okay, and again we measured the capacity of that deployment architecture. And then we reached our goal, the 50 users. Okay, these are the references. There is this block called acceptance. They have the the methodology on how you can calculate the concurrent users. And these are some of them. I have used VistJS for the data visualization. And the RabbitMQ server for messaging between these Capybara nodes, between these two, between the different process running on different servers. Okay, and for the system metrics collection, I have run the the command called PID stat, which actually breaks down the system resource usage for each process. So we can give a time interval of 10 seconds or 1 minute. I have collected it for like 10 seconds. Which I found it's a little bit too much sampling. I think maybe you can increase that time to 60 seconds. So for every minute, you can just collect the resource usage for each process, then actually calculate which process is actually taking more resources and scale. Okay. That's it. Any questions? Thank you.